are celebrating our history, our heritage, our culture, and our own authentic voice. And today we have the distinct honor of welcoming Ann Coger to the set. Welcome to the set, Ann.
Well, thank you so much. It's wonderful to be here.
So, Ann, you know, you're a very interesting person, got a rich background. Tell me a little bit about yourself.
Well, I was born and raised in Baltimore, Maryland, and actually born in Johns Hopkins Hospital, which was different back then for African Americans to be born there. I was raised in Baltimore, part of family from Pennsylvania, part from North Carolina.
Okay.
I went to school, predominantly African American school, and then we moved to a community that was predominantly Jewish. As they were migrating out of the city of Baltimore. And before we moved to that community, my mother decided to do something for the family, an activity. So it was tennis. She started tennis, and my sisters and I, as three of us, we kind of fell in line and started playing too.
So what was that cultural experience growing up in Baltimore? It has a rich history. It was a famous doctor that was a black doctor that was a part of Johns Hopkins University at the time. He sits on the wall.
Well, growing up in Baltimore, it was very much a African-American and Jewish community. The politicians mostly were Caucasian, but the Jewish shopkeepers were the grocery stores in our neighborhood. We went to school. I learned a lot about the Jewish kids when they would go to Jewish school to learn their culture and customs and songs, and they'd come back and teach us. So it was very comfortable. But as I moved into tennis, the African-American people who were playing tennis had as much prejudice against them as the Jewish people. We were not allowed to play in some tournaments at some clubs, and it wasn't just African-American, it was Jewish as well. So it was kind of a double whammy there for a while, and my first girls' doubles partner was a Jewish girl, Janice Tomlinson, and her mother was looking for a partner. My mother was looking for a partner for her daughter, and found out we couldn't find one, so we found each other, and we played all throughout our junior years.
So tennis has a rich history. How was it being a woman and African-American woman, black woman, breaking into that, you know, that circle, that tight-knit circle from a cultural standpoint?
Well, tennis is a sport that is where African-Americans are very much still underrepresented.
Okay.
And breaking into a sport that was still in a segregated town. We had the old colored swimming pools. We played on the old colored tennis courts. And it was very much segregated growing up. But we weren't told that we were kind of like not supposed to do this and not supposed to do that, because I think the adults thought that we should build our self-esteem and be comfortable and proud of what we are doing, and then we could venture into the bigger scheme of things, going to tournaments and things like that. So we had a lot of help there. There were African-American clubs all over the country that belonged to the American Tennis Association. And we would come to Philadelphia and stay in people's homes, because in the North, we knew we had much more opportunities to go places, restaurants. But in the South, you had to stay in people's homes because you couldn't stay in hotels. So, and that was, you know, not that long ago. That was in the 60s, and into the early 70s. So I think I have had the best of both worlds, you know, seeing the ugly part of it to growing up into the wonderful part where there's so many opportunities. And I was given a lot of opportunities. Now, when I ventured to go to college, the racism reared its ugly head, because they recommended that I go to Pepperdine. So I thought,
in California, right?
In California, so I was on my way to Pepperdine. And they said, oh no, we don't give tennis scholarships, and we don't have space for her. So then it was, I would go to Hampton, but Hampton had a men's team. So I ended up, through our club member, being taken to one of his friends, Dr. Jenkins, at Morgan State University. Mm-hmm. And that's where I ended up playing tennis on the men's tennis team and the women's tennis team. So then I have another dynamic to adjust to.
You bring a lot of barriers.
Yes, I'm a barrier breaker, they say. But actually, it's hard, but it's fun. Mm-hmm. Because it's great to see the impression that people and the expressions they have when you tell them you do certain things and they think, oh, it must not be true, you know. But it really did happen.
Now, you're a coach. Mm-hmm. Now, tell people where you coach at and how you broke into the coaching arena.
Well, I coach now at Haverford College, mm-hmm. but I had my first coaching job when I was 18 years old.
Wow.
A tennis player brought his daughter to me to coach, and I was like, I don't know how to coach tennis. I just play. Mm-hmm. He says, well, just teach her how you play. So I was like, okay, no formal training. So I tripped and fell and got up over the years and became a pretty decent tennis player, had an opportunity to play on the Virginia Slims professional tennis circuit, mm-hmm. which was the earliest beginnings of pro tennis, mm-hmm. before the WTA even became into existence. Mm-hmm. And a friend who was from Philadelphia knew a friend who was on the board and an alum of Haverford College, and they were going co-educational. So they brought me up to interview for the job. Well, it just so happened that the first interview was really for the men's tennis job because the person who was coaching was leaving. But the old timers at Haverford weren't ready for a female coach when they had just gone co-educational. Uh-huh. So the athletic director, Dana Swan at that time said, well, would you be interested if we, you know, open up more opportunities for coaching? Mm. And I said, sure. You know, so I played 7 sports in college, and I figure I could do almost anything. I even tried to play football. Coach didn't let me do that. But anyway, so I came to Haverford, and 34.5 years,
wow.
and I'm still there. Some would say I'm a fixture. Some would say it's time for me to move on, but I'm not ready, and hopefully they're not ready for me to go.
So let me ask you this, because Haverford is a Quaker school on the main line in suburbs of Philadelphia. And how can we get more young people of color in tennis from your, you know, experience?
Well, a lot of our seasoned tennis players have our ideas on how to get more kids in tennis. Mm-hmm. Tennis is a pretty expensive sport.
Mm-hmm.
And it starts in the grassroots, just like other sports. You have to get mm-hmm. kids off the playground, off the streets mm-hmm. to start. But then once they get hooked, mm-hmm. you have to have a vehicle to bring them through. And it's also a financial vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
So right now in the USTA, they're trying to tackle that, the United States Tennis Association. Mm-hmm. I think our first African-American female president, Katrina Adams, and some of her think tank have tried to make opportunities better, subsidize players who have shown talent. And actually, we have a lot more girls and boys and men and women who have broken that barrier. It's not as noticeable because they haven't flooded tennis, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. there are a lot more. I mean, I've gone to tournaments where I've seen no participation by African Americans or any other racial group, and now we're there. So it's almost like the dynamics of the changing population mm-hmm. of the United States is fastly changing to become more diverse,
mm-hmm.
and it's showing itself in the sport of tennis. So it's a matter of time. It's coming slowly,
yeah.
too slowly for some, but it's coming.
As we close, I know people chopping at the bit at this, and I know I am. How has Serena or the Williams sisters changed the game of tennis?
She's fabulous.
I agree.
She's fabulous.
I agree.
Well, actually, I look at Serena Williams, and as any tennis player who has aspired to be at her level, mm-hmm. I think, you know, if I could have done that, if I could have, you know. But Serena Williams first is a superior athlete.
Mm-hmm.
And to do the things that she's done, you have to be more than a tennis player.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be an athlete. And she has been able, and which amazes me, to keep the hunger to mm-hmm. win. And it's not necessarily winning titles, it's winning when she's on the court. Mm-hmm. She's all out there to win that match. And nobody's perfect. She's lost a couple championships that mm-hmm. she was expected to win, but she's still on top in points mm-hmm. and money, and physically, she's still in very good shape, so she'll be out there as long as she wants to be. But she is a fabulous role model for anybody who wants to excel in the sport, male and female, and especially for young women. I mean, I see some young girls and, you know, they just talk about Serena Williams like, you know, she's just a goddess. Mm-hmm. And she has done all kinds of wonderful things for the sport of tennis.
Wow, we are out of time, and I'm telling you, I got more questions for Serena, but I'm sorry, we're out of time. Venus is good, too, and the dad was pretty good, too. Hey, we thank you once again for tuning in to 28 Days, where we celebrate our history, our heritage, our culture, and our own authentic voice. And we ask you to tune in once again, and we once again thank Ann Coger for coming to the set. Thank you for coming, and tune in again.